We would definitely be looking forward to that. We look forward to getting our paycheck. We look forward to maybe going out on a date. We look forward to the birth of our children. We look forward to so many different events. But what about heaven? What do we look forward to in heaven? We'll have a new body. There'll be a new earth and a new heaven. We'll get our rewards. We have to start thinking about what we will look forward to there. So today we're going to talk about our hope that we're looking forward to a new body. Verses 18 through 25. Paul said, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creation eagerly waits for the revealing of the sons, the people of God. For the creation was not subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself also will be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. fully know that the whole creation groans and labors with birth pains together until now. Not only that, but we also, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, eagerly waiting for the adoption, the redemption of our body. For we were saved in this hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For why does one still hope for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. So we're looking forward to the redemption of our bodies. And verse 18 says, "For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed to us." Paul, his suffering, do you know what Paul went through? Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, 14 through 18. I want you to read it and understand more about this suffering. Paul says, "Five times I received 40 stripes, 39 stripes. Three times was I beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Three times I was shipwrecked because of a storm or due to a wreck of the ship, and that happened to him three times. A night and a day I have been out in the deep, in journeys often, always moving, never staying settled and comfortable, always moving. In danger and perils of waters, perils of robbers, in perils from my own countrymen, in perils of the Gentiles, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and toil. I often went without sleep, and hunger and thirst, and fastings often, and cold and nakedness, besides the other things, what comes upon me daily, my deep concern for all the churches. Who is weak, and I am not weak? Who is made to stumble, and I do not burn with indignation?" So Paul's sufferings, all of those beatings and stripes and scourging and all of that, he says it's nothing compared to the glory that will be revealed in heaven. Now I'm looking into my life and my suffering. Is my suffering similar to Paul's suffering? Or maybe you have experienced something worse than Paul. But Paul's comparing his own to future glory, and he's saying it's nothing, it's temporary. That's a strong, strong statement. Now, in verse 19. Paul seemed confident that glory was coming. In verse 19, creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God. Verse 20. Creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope. Because the creation itself will also be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. One day we will become fully sons of God. What does that mean? We'll get a new body without any sin. We will have no sin and we'll be fully his children. That will be revealed in the future. We're not full of glory right now. We can't be. We still have our flesh. We still have our sin. But Paul is saying that all of creation, remember, Adam and Eve ate the fruit, disobeyed God, and sin began. Original sin began. God didn't say, oh, that's okay, I forgive you. He said, you have disobeyed against me. And he broke fellowship. That separation from him was their punishment. They were removed from the garden and they struggled from that point on. So until now we're still frustrated with sin. We're still struggle with sin. Our flesh. God punishes us. We have to go through it to struggle with our sin. But God teaches us to look forward eagerly, to be hungry for him. We have to become masters of our body, masters of our flesh now. And then when we enter glory, we'll receive a new body. We're going to talk about that more in the next hour. So you notice creation in verse 20. Joe, I don't know what your translation is. Mine is NIV. NIV uses the word frustration. Does your translation say futility? Futility is almost means like there's no hope. Frustration sounds like, oh, I'm frustrated, but hopeless, without hope. Frustration sounds like, hurry up, I'm eager. Frustration sounds like you're looking forward to, and futility sounds like you have no hope. That word means no stability. Hope is like a strong tower. And futility means kind of unstable. Paul uses that word, futility. I'm not sure about frustration. creation, there was disobedience against God, and at that point, there was no more hope because they were separated from God. They couldn't get to heaven. So God made a plan, and he told them, you will have hope. You will. I'll provide a way for salvation through Jesus. But Paul says that to force us to look back at history and think, we're going to have a new body. We're going to be with God. We'll have no flesh and sin disrupting us anymore. First, you have to be saved, obviously. Our creation, ever since the fall, it felt like there has been no hope. But Paul says that there is a hope to look forward to Christ in heaven. And also, you might notice the word groaning in verse 22 and 23. So the first fruits of the Spirit, the Christians in Rome, he was writing this to them. Those who believed in Christ, who were following Christ, they had the Holy Spirit. And we groan, we struggle. Myself, lately, I've experienced a lot of groaning. You know, I just, meeting with people that struggle, and it's just disheartening. And I tell them, Jesus doesn't want us to sin that way. And I tried to talk with one person, and it made me feel like I was groaning in my spirit, and prayed and supported them. And other times I'll experience temptation, and it'll be like a groaning. Why do we have to have this temptation? It's like, flesh, stop it. But it's this groaning, and we look forward to Jesus. Help us to resist it. Help us. We look forward to a life without sin, a life without temptation, a life without struggle. I do look forward to that. I feel like, when will I be raptured, or when if I die? But I'm eager to do his work. Like, Jamie's grandmother will be 95 this summer. I'm like, wow, to be 95. Or Billy Graham, who lived to be 99. That's a long life of service to God. But I'm already groaning. But I'm touched that you want me to serve you on this earth. So what do you want me to do? And I look forward to that, but it's a struggle. Do you have an experience? Have you experienced that? Sometimes when you think about the future, you know it's hard now. And you think, can I deal with it for 40 more years? I can compare my physical body now with construction. If I was, when I was 20, would I hurt like I do now? If I did, I wouldn't be able to handle it. But I've gained strength and I've become stronger. My shoulders hurt now, but I just say, well, I know I'll just get up. And go on, my knee will hurt, but I just get up and I walk around and stretch it out. I think it's the same way with our spirit. We become stronger. Now we struggle with small things, but years later, you know, we'll have so much more experience, and when a big thing comes up, we'll know how to handle it, we'll know how to take care of it, and we'll know how to give it to God. That's why James says that all of our struggles build our character, our patience. God has a purpose and a plan for that. I wonder if when we have a new body and we're in heaven, all of our experiences, will they still apply to our life in heaven? Sometimes I do wonder what I'm learning now, will it benefit me in heaven? Or you'll wipe it out and leave it on earth and everything's new? In a simple prayer, our Father says, "Thy will be done on earth as it is done in heaven." Really, that is for my Sunday school lesson. We're going to talk about judgment. All our experiences here on earth do have a purpose for later. So if you're curious and you want to know what that means, just stay for the next class. So now, my question is it possible for us to look forward and really want to be with Jesus, or are we just looking forward to getting away from hell, escaping hell, basically? Is that the wrong reason? Yeah, we can do that. If you do, does that mean that you're really saved? Something to think about. I think from my personal experience that word for word is the reason that why I became saved, because I didn't want to go to hell. But from my experience, it's like you're still a baby, like a newborn on milk, and you don't understand heaven. You don't have a relationship with God yet. My only knowledge was that I feared God. I didn't want to go to hell. I didn't want to be separated. But as I grew and as I learned more, then I forgot about hell. And I wanted more to just be close to God. I knew that would be an opportunity in heaven to be with Him full time.
I'm dead.
It's common to hear about salvation, but really there's more to salvation. Not only can you be reconciled to God through Jesus, Romans 3, 4, and 5 explains about that. And after you accept Christ, what do? Are you just relieved that you're saved? But it's not the end. There's the process of sanctification. Your old life and your old habits are being set aside and you're changing to become more like Christ. Romans 6 and 7 talks about that. And now we're in Romans 8 where it talks about glorification, becoming perfect when we enter heaven. And we get rid of our old body. And right now, we all haven't passed away, so we're still here in sanctification. And when we go home, we'll be in glorification. Paul wrote this. But Jesus shared this when he talked about sowing the seeds. Those who weren't saved and the seed on the weeds and the thorn. Thank you. Those who don't want to go through struggles and those who hold on to God. But some people are not willing to go through this sanctification, but it's part of our salvation. If you don't have any sanctification, then you're not really saved. The ultimate purpose of our salvation is for the glorification. I don't know if you've heard me teach before about letting God mold us. We're the clay, he's the potter. And just letting God mold us until he is satisfied with us and he brings us home. If we're not done, he's not done with us. Does that kind of fit your comment? Yeah. So often, people who are not saved, who fully surrender their life to God, often will leave during this sanctification process. How do you know? When you look at 1 John 2 and verse 19. They went out from us. They were not of us, for if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. And then in verse 15, it says, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but it is of the world. And the world and its desires are passing away. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Often we say, yeah, I'm saved. I accepted Jesus. I believe. That's it. Or you're afraid of hell. I don't want hell, so I will accept Jesus. That's a common reason for accepting Christ. But to fully submit, you know, God says I have to do all this. Oh, I can't do that. I don't want anything to do with that. So maybe they were not saved in the first place. It's important when we're witnessing, when someone says they want Christ, we need to make sure that they understand they have to fully surrender their life to him. They have to resist temptation. They have to ask God for his help to not fall into sin, to not fall into the world in their old life. Make sure they understand that instead of just they just accept Christ as if it wasn't serious, but it is very serious. important part of Christian life, but only God can judge. For example, the thief on the cross who hung with Jesus. He said, I accept you. He hadn't had a life of sanctification yet. So it's not my place to judge, but it's just my place to warn that it can be dangerous to make sure you are working out your salvation. Make sure I really am saved. And, you know, if you feel guilty, that's a warning sign to obey God's will. Repent. I think studying 1 Kings.
That's us. I've been reading it, and I've noticed that a lot of times Saul would do things that made sense. I would look at his situation, I would think, okay, I can see that. But God would rebuke him, even though it looked like he was following God. There was one time before a battle, and Samuel hadn't shown up, and he saw his troops leaving. So he made a sacrifice to God. That sounds right. That sounds okay. But God said, Samuel told him, because of that you will lose your kingdom. David had already known that he would become king. And two times he had the opportunity to stop a lot of people from suffering because he had the chance to kill Saul. He didn't do it. That didn't make sense. And I really struggled with why God would rebuke Saul for doing something that made sense and praise David for doing something that didn't make sense. And it finally really just hit me that God's the only being that can see reasons. It doesn't matter what we do, we can go to church, not go to church, whatever. He knows why we did it. David let Saul live for the right reason, because he wanted to please God. Saul sacrificed to God, which sounds like a good thing, for the wrong reason, because he was scared that God wasn't in control. And I think a lot of times that's our problem. We think we have to take, I think I have to take control. So often.
You're not alone.
Yeah.
You're in good company.
But, you know, we have to realize that we can't fool God. He knows why and why we do something. We can't just follow the rules. We can't, there's no step by step for being a good Christian. We have to want to please Him. Thank you.
13, Part B, says, foods for the stomach and the stomach for foods. But God will destroy both. Now the body is not for sexual immorality, but for the Lord. And the Lord for the body. Makes us think in that verse. Also in verse 19 through 20, let's go ahead and read that. Do you not know that your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have from God, and you are not your own? You don't own your body. God owns your body. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is inside of you. So our spirit, our soul, is put down into our body so that God can enter into our body through the Holy Spirit. Physical sin. God wants to use our body to teach us. If we didn't have a body, if we just had a soul floating around, how could we experience different ways to worship God? We can't fully understand it's God's wisdom to make us this way, to experience physical things. Philippians 1:20. I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, so now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. So the purpose of our body is to exalt Jesus' name. So a body is important. People look at what I do with my body. Suppose people know that I'm having affairs. Does that exalt Christ? People rely on your body to look at you to see how you are exalting God. If you're drinking too much, if you become drunk, does that exalt Christ? So the physical is important. How do we exalt Christ with our body? The last two verses, and then we will close. Romans 6. Forgiven my sins. I confess my sins to him. I agree to follow him. He asked for my body. That's tough. I have to let go of my desires and let his desires become mine. Let him use me. Mm-hmm. And again in Romans 12:1. Therefore, my brothers, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. That is my spiritual act of worship. My body, my spirit, and my heart worship God. And my body also worships God. If my spirit sins, then my body sins as well. If my spirit's in my body, I'm to worship him. God uses me. Like Paul, he went on so many journeys, he experienced so many beatings. But his motive was to please God, to exalt his name. I've got to surrender my life to God, just like we're supposed to follow that example. And that's hard. You know, our flesh is temporary. You're afraid to die. Satan has no control over me. God owns me. When I die, God will take me, take my spirit, and give me a new body for eternity. That's the most important thing to do. The most important act of worship is to glorify his name with my body. I thought it was an interesting study. But we still battle. There's still a battle between our flesh and our spirit. There's a war in Romans 7, it's clear. Until we're buried, we will continue to battle. So, of course, we look forward to being with Jesus, and another reason that we can look forward to is getting a new body someday. Paul's point is really more of turning to Jesus, to looking to Jesus. In your spirit and your body. And I want us to remember that every day, wherever we go, whatever we do, how I use my body is for Jesus. That's the mindset that we should have every day, including our food. I'm guilty. We don't eat right. Exercising, I don't do that often. Tomorrow I'm supposed to start CrossFit. My body is really going to become a living sacrifice tomorrow, or maybe Tuesday. Tuesday morning, my body will become a living sacrifice. I will beat myself and experience pain and suffering.